Richard Rogers, 1933-2021. He died yesterday on the 18th of December 2021, and I think his age was 88 years old. So he had a long life, but still death is something we shouldn't take lightly, and it is an end that waits for all of us. Ingmar Bergman said that there was not one single day in his life without thinking about death. And Cesare Zavattini, an important writer and screen, he also wrote screenplays and so on, wrote that if it was up to him, he would have announced publicly to everyone all over the world that one day they will die. Unfortunately, or maybe fortunately, we do not think about death. I would say unfortunately, because of being carried away by our own lives, we forget the ending, and the ending is unavoidable. I don't know, was it Franklin who said, that only two things are unavoidable, death and paying your taxes? Something like this, not exactly with these words, but this was the meaning. So let me read. Richard George Rogers, Baron Rogers of Riverside, born in July 1933 and died yesterday on the 18th of December 2021, was an Italian born. This is perhaps less known, that he was actually born in Italy. An Italian-born British architect noted for his modernist and functionalist designs in high-tech architecture. The text is from Wikipedia, and we'll comment more about his works. I think this description is a little bit simplistic, but it tells the truth to an extent. Rogers was perhaps best known for his work on the Pompidou Center in Paris, the Lloyd's Building and Millennium Dome, both in London, the Senate Building in Cardiff, and the European Court of Human Rights Building in Strasbourg. He was a winner. By the way of that, we had a friend of ours here on Zoom last year, Mahadev Rahman, who was actually the mechanical engineer for that building, European Court of Human Rights Building in Strasbourg. And he told us interesting things. And if you are interested, you can see his own lecture on YouTube, Mahadev Rahman. He was a winner, not Mahadev Rahman, but Richard Rogers. He was a winner of the Riba Gold Medal, the Thomas Jefferson Medal, the Riba Sterling Prize, the Minerva Medal, and the Pritzker Prize. He was a senior partner at Rogers Stark Harbor and Partners, previously known as the Richards Rogers Partnership until the 30th of June, 2020. Richard Rogers was born in Florence, Tuscany, in Italy, in 1933 into an Anglo-Italian family. His father, William Nino Rogers, was the cousin of Italian architect Ernesto Nathan Rogers. His ancestors moved from Sunderland to Venice in about 1800, later settling in Trieste, Milan, and Florence. In 1939, William Nino Rogers decided to come back to England. Upon moving to England, Richard Rogers went to St. John's School, Leatherhead. Rogers did not excel academically, which made him believe that he was stupid because he could not read or memorize his schoolwork. And as a consequence, he stated that he became very depressed. He wasn't able to read until the age of 11, and it was not until after he had his first child that he realized that he was dyslexic. Schools should know this, that sometimes brilliant people do not well in school, apparently do not do well in school, but it doesn't, this doesn't mean much. After leaving St. John's School, he undertook a foundation course at Epsom School of Art, now University for the Creative Arts, before going into national service between 1951 and 1953. He then attended the Architectural Association School of Architecture in London, that formidable school which gave to the world so many great architects, where he gained the Architectural Association's diploma from 1954 until 1959, subsequently graduating with a master's degree from the Yale School of Architecture in 1962 in the United States on a Fulbright scholarship. While studying at Yale, Rogers met fellow architecture student Norman Foster and planning student Sue Bramwell, who later became his wife. After leaving Yale, he joined Skidmore, Owings & Merrill in New York. On returning to England in 1963, he, Norman Foster, and Bramwell set up architectural practice as Team Four with Andy Chisman. Bramwell later married Rogers, Chisman married Foster. Rogers and Foster earned a reputation for what was later termed by the media high-tech architecture. So here he was. And I would say he continues to be, maybe a touch of depression remained with him or some melancholia. His face expresses a certain sadness, although he had a very successful life and career. I mean, I don't know about the life, but his career as an architect was without doubt successful. Here they are together. On the right, Richard Rogers, or should I say Sir Richard Rogers, and on the left, Norman Foster, or should I say Sir Norman Foster, both students at Yale in the United States. Now, some sketches and drawings. These are sketches done for his last work. And I will end this presentation with a building itself, which was built. So I'll just show a few sketches for this last building that he built before he retired from his own company or his own firm. But I'll show a few other drawings as well. I like this building very much because it, in a way, it's his swan song. You know, it's a building which truly wants to take off. And in many ways it does, I would say. Anyway, it's a small art gallery. I found a few sketches and drawings and renderings by him. He's known as a high-tech architect, but I think his architecture has a certain humanism that is hidden behind the appearance of being high-tech. I would say even a certain warmth, at least some of his buildings. But he did build some extremely important buildings for our age. Okay, now let's start with Renzo Piano. Now, this is a picture of him, Renzo Piano and Richard Rogers from 1976. I imagine they won already the Centre Pompidou competition, which was a remarkable achievement. And from what I read, I think Renzo Piano said that they didn't expect it to win at all. In fact, when they took part in the competition, they said from the very beginning, we are not going to win, so we'll just do whatever we want to do without consideration for whatever the judges or the jury might think, and they won. They also were helped by a brilliant engineer, Peter Rice, and we are going to see a picture with him too. In fact, all three of them. In the front, Richard Rogers, and they are during the construction of Centre Georges Pompidou. Richard Rogers behind Renzo Piano, and the third one, Peter Rice, truly, is considered a genius in structural engineering, but unfortunately he died young, 40 or 40 something. Now you are going to see a picture here of the Team Four, the first, so-called office or company they set up. So the Team Four, the members of this team, there were more than four, but the founding members were four. We are going to see a picture of them. So they were photographed in 1966, and here they are. the four that are, you know, gave the name to the company are these ones, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, what is a little bit strange here is that the Sir Norman Foster has in his proximity the future wife of Richard Rogers. And this lady here, she became the wife of Norman Foster. So anyway, let's see their names. So it's Norman Foster, Sue Bramwell, Richard Rogers, and Wendy Chisman. So this is Sue, and this is Wendy. So this is Wendy, the future wife of Sir Norman Foster, and Sue, the future wife, or maybe they were already married, of Sir Richard Rogers. And the others were probably part of the team. And the first job they had was actually commissioned by the parents of Sue. Apparently they were well-to-do, and is this very project, the Creek Bean in Cornwall in the UK, in the United Kingdom. This was their first project, and it was built for the parents of Sue Bramwick. So this is the very beginning of a doubly remarkable career, not just of Richard Rogers, but of course, Norman Foster as well. And they both received the Pritzker Prize. I would say a remarkable achievement, no? And this happened, apparently, Richard Rogers brought good luck to the teams he worked with, because he worked also with Renzo Piano, and Renzo Piano also got the Pritzker Prize. Now, I'm not trying to say that it's because of Richard Rogers, but somehow it was auspicious to work with Richard Rogers. I wish I did too. This is a very nice little shed, sunk into the earth. I will have more pictures of it. The retreat, here it is, you know, and I read today an article about the bunkers that people build all over the United States, to protect themselves in case of an atomic disaster. Well, this is obviously not made for something like this. It's very fragile, exactly at the top. But I find it very, very nice. So this is an early work by Team 4. The house built for the parents of Richard Rogers' wife, Sue. This gentleman drawn here in this sketch obviously is not afraid of the atomic disaster. Now, Reliance Controls Factory in Swindon, UK, 1967, already a building that announces the aesthetics of both Richard Rogers and Norman Foster. Now, after Team 4 dissolved, Richard and Sue Rogers, they formed their own company called Richard and Sue Rogers Architects with John Young and Laurie Abbott. And this is a project, the Zip-Up House, which was designed between 1967 and 1969 for the House of Today competition. Not today, but from that time, 1967, which was sponsored by DuPont. It was exhibited at that ideal home exhibition in London. The design was for a factory built house, quick to assemble and reassemble with cheap insulation panels that I used on refrigeration trucks with rapid construction at low cost. Richard Rogers wrote, buying clothes off the rack is the norm. We wanted to do the same for the house, an affordable, speedy kit of parts. And I think this democratic outlook on life that, Sir Richard Rogers had was a quality that he had. It is felt in his buildings, in his works. It's not aloof, his architecture. Although he built some buildings, luxury buildings, if I can call them so, but there is a certain freshness and sincerity in his architecture, which is probably connected with what I just read. Now, Piano and Rogers, they formed the company and they had several works done before they won the competition for the Pompidou Center. You see here the Universal Oil products, the B&B Italia headquarters, a little bit later, they won the competition for the Pompidou Center. Then they did other works, IRCAM in Paris, PET Center Research Laboratory in Melbourne, and so on. Here they are, the happy winners of the Pompidou Center, and I'm so happy that there are so many students here to get inspired by this, I would say, very inspiring picture with two young architects who, they taking risks, they won. So thank you to the many students who are here and get inspired by this picture, and I hope by the next parts of this presentation. B&B Italia, 1972-1973. Yes, the magic of assembling logically but aesthetically pleasing also various steel parts, remained with Rogers till the end, and is beautifully illustrated in his last building, which I call the Swan Song. Richard Rogers' Swan Song. Primary colors, why not? They say yes to life in a joyous way, and I think the more we have them, the better. I mean, why should a factory look depressing? Why can't it celebrate life in a chromatically engaging way? Now the Pompidou Center, Paris, 1971-1977. We all know this building. It's a building that Paris had the courage to build, and the architects had the courage to imagine and to propose. And again, I keep saying it pays to take risks. You can imagine, it was a very courageous gesture to propose something like this in this, urban environment. And they did, and they won. It was a spirited project, and I'm happy it won. Although many years ago, I was myself rather a little bit, questioning this techno optimism, but I came to appreciate it. And as I said, they benefited from a brilliant engineer, Peter Rice, a structural engineer who went on to work also for the glass pyramid by Pei at the Louvre, and even did some work at the Opera in Sydney, a very, very important structural engineer. They were all young and restless. The Richards Rogers partnership. After a while, we saw a short list with the projects he did together with Renzo Piano. Then he started the Richard Rogers partnership. And let's look at this very important work, equally very important work, the Lloyds in London, 1984. Richard Rogers' first high-tech building. And so it is, but although I am not a high-tech person, so to speak, I do appreciate this architecture. It is, it has verve, it is vivacious, it is alive, and it is an organism, a metallic organism, it is a techno organism, but I feel it's not a dead building, despite the fact that it is so-called high-tech. And I think the spirit of Richard Rogers shows through and through, and there is a sculpturalness. You know, it's a building which is not static, both outside and inside. We had with us, as I said last year, a brilliant engineer, mechanical engineer, who worked on this building, and told us some things about how mechanically this building was functioning. He was very young at the time. I'm talking about Mahadev Raman. But this was an exciting project, and it went on to establish Richard Rogers as a force in architecture. This he did without Renzo Piano. But just like at Centre Georges Pompidou, he brought outside the so-called serving areas, as Louis Kahn would have called them, stairs and, mechanical spaces and elevators and, restrooms and so on. They're all brought outside, and they all actually are architecturally and sculpturally, they are the most interesting parts. Otherwise, the building is, nothing exceptional really about it, but because of these things outside, brought courageously outside, there is something of a metabolist architecture here. And I was thinking of Kikutake, who also had projects where he brought outside the so-called serving spaces. They create exactly these serving areas or spaces. They create the chance to do something different, to escape from the predictability of the so-called clean prism. I like the visceralization of architecture, and this is what we are looking at here. It's all honestly brought outside, not inside, not hidden. Louis Kahn wanted to enclose them in the towers of Richard's laboratories in Philadelphia. He was afraid of letting the pipes disturb the architecture of the building. Here the pipes are taken out of the building and display courageously. So I think again this has to do with a certain level of sincerity and of openness, and I think we need more of that. Reuters data center in London, 1987-1992. He did many projects, and here I only show some, but in no way all his works. European Court of Human Rights, which I already mentioned, we read about it in Strasbourg in 1994. He had some experience in this, and we are going to see two remarkable, I think both of them I will be shown towards the end of this presentation, palaces of justice, if we are to call them in this more maybe emphatic way, but essentially having to do with with lawyers, the courtrooms and so on, European Court of Human Rights. I showed the other day, also a similar function served by David Chipperfield in Barcelona. In my opinion, morose work, some kind of a morose elegance there. But this here, what we look at is not morose. It's okay, maybe it's not a very, very special, metallic building, but I wouldn't call it morose. And I like about his architecture that you see how things are done, how it is built, the building, how the building came into being, how it was built. This is, I think, in opposition to what many do today. Jean Nouvel said in the past, it was a virtue to show the structure of a building. But today, he thought, Jean Nouvel, structure is, there seemed to be a tendency, he thought, of hiding, how the structure actually functioned. I don't know, that was Jean Nouvel's opinion, a statement. Okay, the Strasbourg building by Sir Richard Rogers. And now we look at a building in Japan, Kabuki Cho Tower in Tokyo, 1987-1993. Again, Richard Rogers building, interesting in terms of volume, in terms of its culturalness, functional, yes, maybe his architecture is not very unpredictable, but I don't know. I mean, if you compare this building to this one here, you see a difference. The fact that he courageously uses, so-called strong colors, and it's a building which has a freshness of vision. Yes, employing technological aesthetics, but I think it's a good building, and the Daimler Chrysler building in Berlin, equally so. Here in the back, you see a fragment of a building of his former partner, Renzo Piano. This is the building by Richard Rogers. Arata Isozaki built here too, and others. So this is Richard Rogers. It's not bad. And it has a certain optimism, which is kind of surprising when we remember his face in some pictures. Didn't seem like a happy man in some pictures, but in others he did. Anyway, this is in Berlin, close to, or it's part of Potsdamer Platz. We were lucky last year to have the Sony Center, which is very close to this building. We had the structural engineer, Bruce Danziger, who was the structural engineer for that building, built by Helmut Jahn, and which is not far away from this building by Sir Richard Rogers. I'm mentioning Bruce Danziger because he was often present here on this Zoom platform, and he even made a presentation about unconventional structure. So here is Renzo Piano, and here we have Sir Richard Rogers. Berlin. Now, the Channel 4 headquarters in London, 1990-1994. You can see Richard Rogers brought in his architecture playfulness, not just chromatic. And this is, I think, and he was able to marry it or express it through high-tech components. Now this sculpture or sculptural thing here is not his, but the building is behind. You see echoes of Centre Georges Pompidou. Now, the Welsh Parliament in Cardiff, UK, 1999-2005, another fine building by Sir Richard Rogers. Look at that roof. You know, it's impressive, you know, and also the inside is impressive. It's a building that that is not without the ability to stir up emotions. And it's a building serving the high-end bureaucracy of a parliament, but it's a playful building because of this central part, which makes all the difference. So the kid who couldn't read until he was 11 and who felt was stupid became one of the important architects of today's world. This should make us think, you know, about how we evaluate students. Why should one always follow the predictable path? As Albert Einstein said, if a fish is forced to climb a tree, will think for the rest of its life that is stupid because it cannot do it. The fish is supposed to be in the water. Well, you know, there are many students who don't fit in certain academic settings, and they are dismissed or even humiliated by those academic systems. But we have here the example of a student who was not good in school, and then he won a Fulbright scholarship, studied at Yale, and then earned the Pritzker Prize and all the rest. And we talk about him today because he died yesterday at 88. And look at what this student who had troubles to read until 11 built for the parliament in Wales. Bravo to him. It is impressive. And this is not a little house built for an extravagant artist or whatever. This is for the highest, bureaucratic, body of the political hierarchy. It takes courage, it takes vision, and it takes knowing how. Sorry about the resolution of this picture. This roof extended as it is welcoming you, is protecting you. I imagine when you go inside this building, you feel protected, not just against the rain. Now, I mentioned I will show another law court in France. This one is in Belgium, Antwerp law court, which is itself creative work, and very different from the one in France. I prefer the one in France, but this one is also, I would say, interesting and engaging and sculptural. And because in a way, you know, human justice should aspire towards, you know, being close to divine justice. So maybe these triangles pointing upwards, you know, try to suggest exactly this. He was an excellent architect, you know. I mean, if you enter this building, I imagine you you have the feeling and the confidence that, you know, nothing will be hidden, and that just like the building, which expressing its openness and has a dynamic space, the dynamics of making justice will happen. I like to think. Now, this is the work I mentioned before, Le Palais de Justice de Bordeaux, the court palace or not palace, courtroom or whatever, the building. Yeah, the Palace of Justice of Bordeaux in France from 1993 to 1999. I like this work very much. It's different from the previous work, but I would say, excellent. It's brilliant, you know, because it's a high-tech building, but also it's something archetypal, atavistic, almost primitive. You know, these are almost the chapels of justice, if I am to call them so. Open at the top to communicate vertically with the one who is watching us. That is, if you have some fear, you know, related to someone who might watch us, we human beings. I don't know, but it's truly a brilliant work, you know, because without words, it's communicating this duality in a way, you know, the quest for justice on earth, and then another level of the quest for justice. And that is, you know, in my opinion, related to your own conscience, you know, and thus through your own conscience to, you know, to what is above us, if there is anything above us. Because of, I mean, you know, this is almost a science fiction architecture done with a very specific purpose. I think it is remarkable. In a way, I think these buildings tell you, do not fear. Do not fear because, you know, in this chapel of justice, the light comes from the top, just like in a chapel. And there is a chance that we can act according to the divine law and not just to the often depressingly prosaic and measurable rules made by humans. I may be getting carried away a little bit by lyricism, but I wonder why did Richard Rogers make these rooms look like chapels? A look at that light, how it comes from above. It's hard for me to believe that it doesn't have an effect on those who, you know, administrate justice or try to. Look here, it's like a chapel. It's almost like a sacred space. And in a way, you know, delivering justice or questing for justice should be in a way, you know, connected with what we call the sacred. It should be a sacred responsibility to try to tell the truth and to establish justice here on earth. It's a very, very interesting and engaging building. Now the Madrid Barajas Airport, Terminal 4. Again, we know that he was a master of expressing artistically the power of technology and of structure. So this is Terminal 4 in Madrid, Madrid Airport. And we are going to see a few other works, including some housing he did for very modest, if not disadvantaged people. And I admire this, but we are going also to see some blocks of flats built for, you know, those with significant means. The Millennium Dome in London, 1996-1999. I think in the case of Richard Rogers, there is no doubt he was an architect. Let's put it very simply. You know, some other architects are also writers or painters or Richard Rogers was an architect, but was an architect who also enjoyed bringing into his buildings, you know, colors and sculpturalness, and I'm glad he did. Look at this structure, you know, it is, you don't need any sculptures around because the structure itself is sculptural. It is functional, but it is also artistically engaging and significant and enticing and exciting. Now this, this artwork here does not belong to him, but it's okay. I think the artwork enjoys itself, you know, under this generous cover. The Millennium Dome. Now he changed to another partnership, Rogers, Turk, Harbour and Partners. And because they had so many works that, you know, I guess he needed more people. The British Museum, World Conservation and Exhibition Center in London, 2007-2014. Here it is a different kind of architecture, more discreet, more reticent, but very elegant. One Hyde Park, London, 2007-2010 is about these four blocks of flats, high-end blocks of flats. That is not for proletarians, but he built also for proletarians, as I like to call them. They are very fine buildings, and you see they are not inhibited by the proximity of these older buildings. And I think they fit into the physical context in okay terms, if I am to call them so. I remember what Johann Huizinga said, if you want to preserve culture, you have to create it. And this is exactly what Sir Richard Rogers did. You know, in order to preserve the culture of the past, he had to create it. And he created it in the terms of his time and place. And good for him. Thus, you do not feel stuck into the past. You feel you are part of a dynamic process on the spiral of time. Yes, these are opulent apartments, as I said. Look at it. I mean, it's huge, and you know, not anybody could live here. But still, I think through the engaging silhouette and through the joy they express, they belong to everybody. Even if, of course, not everybody could live in such a building. Now the Y cube in London. These are extensions of his generosity towards those who are not privileged. This is social housing at very modest means, but he tried to bring his talent to even such a program with, of course, much less money than what we saw before. But still, the colors are joyous, and I like very much that a Sir Richard Rogers found so-called time to work for something like this. Bravo to him, because I think good architects should not only work for an elite, but should work for everybody, and maybe with a certain interest in those who would benefit the most from something like this. Who said, I read recently, Lübeck, I don't pronounce his name well, an architect born in Georgia and working in he was a communist and working in Great Britain. I presented his work a few days ago, and he said, you know, nothing is too good for ordinary people. I don't like the word ordinary, but I think the meaning is, clear. For those who are very, you know, needy, we have to give the most. And look at this house, you know, it's so different. Look at this apartment from the previous apartments that we look at. Look at the size of the door, and you understand how small this. But this is, I think, for temporary housing units. And yes, an important architect of today built them and designed them. And look, they come to the site already equipped. Prefabricated architecture, why not? Now, I think I am approaching the end of this presentation. He also worked for this so-called place, Ladywell in London, from 2014 to 2016, the Ladywell pop-up village. So it's the UK's first pop-up village with temporary homes, a cool cafe, a thriving indoor market and workspace for entrepreneurs and charities. The resident takes a peek at this cool new community hangout. When Ladywell Leisure Center was demolished in 2014, Lewisham Council decided to put the site to good use. Instead of leaving a yawning gap in the high street, while new build and estate regeneration programs were being developed for the site. The council worked with architects Richard Rogers, Sturck and Harbour and partners, his new firm, to create place, a Lego Bright temporary residential development, offering a short-term solution to the housing crisis in the borough. And actually the buildings as built are look more interesting and alive than the rendering. And here they are, you know, again, built for so-called ordinary people by Sir Richard Rogers. And we are going to see a few scenes from the life there. I like what is going on here. You know, I really think there is hope in diminishing or even erasing the frontiers between what we call art and what we call ordinary people. The good hope is the second site for the cafe that runs to raise funds for the charity for Jimmy. The original site in Heather Green is currently undergoing a refit following a flood. Indeed, it is good hope. With simple means, yes. The indoor market at Place Ladywell includes the Thunder and Lightning Fashion Boutique run by this person, Morgan, and she has a name, Morgan Weber Newman. And look at her, she's happy. I read that she always wanted to have her boutique and she couldn't afford it, but she smiled. She smiled because the architects were social, they had social concerns and made this available to her. Or a florist run by this person, again with a name, Anne-Marie Lichmore, who sells both silk and real floral arrangements. Look at the beautiful flowers. And then an Italian deli, we love pasta, run by Sicilian Corrado Scala. I guess, you know, Richard Rogers was also nostalgic towards his upbringing in Italy when he was a kid, selling homemade tagliatelle, organic sauces, ice cream, and more. Here it is, also democratically offered the chance to those low-budget entrepreneurs. And there is also a bring and fix, inviting people to share their skills, fix bikes and more. And here he is, fixing bikes. Why? Because he likes to do it. And now his last work, and with this I end this commemorative presentation. This work I like very much, and I consider it his swan's work, a gallery that cantilevers 27 meters out above the hillside of the Chateau Lacoste vineyard in southern France. And look at this, you know, it's almost magical. It's only touching the earth here. And of course, there were other cantilevered works built, but this one, I think it's done exquisitely and brilliantly. Look at this, it's saying hello to gravity. I guess Sir Richard Rogers was telling us hello, preparing for the big departure. Or maybe we shouldn't call it the big departure, who knows? It's a beautiful work, really is. Using orange, you know, the color of the Netherlands, or at least its soccer team. The gallery without the artworks, it is as it is, but seen from the outside, is quite well done. And literally, it only touches here the ground, and yes, it is connected also here, but otherwise you have the feeling that this thing is actually flying, and it's exquisitely designed and built. I think it's a very joyous goodbye or hello that Sir Richard Rogers addressed to all of us, because after he built this, he retired. And very different work from the house here. This building that is taking off like a plane, from the earth or from the hill. And yeah, I would say it's his hello address to us. Thank you.